This is Joe Gurney, and I'm going to go through his bio here real quick. Joe's from New York originally. Went to Parks College over here in 1966, St. Louis University, the Bachelor of Science degree, Engineering and Aeroadmin. 66 to 68 was with the Army at Fort Hood, Texas, as a was a headquarters 2nd Armored Division. Was a flight data controller, okay, at the air control tower there, also a refueler. Worked at McDonnell Douglas and then May Boeing from St. Louis from 1968 to April of 1999, so 31 years career out there at the, where's Fred at, like you like to say, the aircraft factory?
Airplane factory.
Airplane factory, my bad. And retired from that. So that included configuration, data management, engineering change proposal writer for the F-4 Phantom. Blue Angels and Thunderbirds, was that like a liaison job? Okay. Composite wing development, worked on the FA-18 Hornet, the T-45, the Harrier, Night Attack version Harrier, flight sims, and space shuttle aft propulsion integration. Went on to Raytheon Missile Systems in Tucson from 99 to 2001 in their product data management, and then contractor to Boeing from 01 to 2007 on the Comanche helicopter flight simulator data management. Loves still photography, video photography, aviation museum, his grandkids, the Rams and the Cards. So I'd like to introduce Joe Gurney. Come on up. With Joe tonight is Dave Pencil. Takes me a couple of times. I'll give you a bio real quick. During college, you say, you worked at Emerson Electric Engineering Department on rocket launch pods for Army helicopters, I assume the Cobra. That's interesting. And then in 67, so you started Engineering Department drafting, working on the F-4 Phantom at McDonnell Douglas. Left MAC to teach industrial arts at Lutheran High North for 19 years. Worked in communications department, photography and video at Lutheran Hour Ministries on radio and TV programs, 20 offices worldwide. Did that for 15 years. Professional photographer in his image photography. Weddings, portraits, commercial jobs for 45 years. Obviously loves and collects model planes, trains, and die-cast cars. So come on up, Dave. Yeah. Okay, all right, sorry. There we go. Get out of the way here.
Okay, I guess we've got some volume here. I'll try and keep it soft for you. Alan, is that okay?
That's good.
Okay. Many thanks tonight to Dan O'Hara and Alan Huffman. I'd like to give them thanks for helping setting up this event and all the background preparations that have gone into it. Thanks to Dave Kunzel also for the many pictures and displays, models, and just all around helping me going to the air shows and taking the still photography of the wonderful aerial shots. Thanks, Dave. Dave will be presenting after I'm done, and we'll let his surprise capture what he's going to talk about besides aerial photography. He's got a special, some things he wants to talk to you about tonight. We've got two short videos and a major video of 25 minutes to show you tonight in addition to some background history on the Blue Angels. The first short video is a Blue Angels aircraft timeline from 1946 to present. And I give thanks to the Blue Angels Alumni Association in Pensacola, and also to the leader of the Blue Angels, Gil Rutt, who was the leader on the Blue Angels team from 1986 to 1988. Gil made a presentation of the 60th anniversary back in the year 2006 at our local St. Louis Boeing facilities, and that's why I was able to meet him. And he donated a lot of the pictures that we're going to show on the timeline. Also, many thanks goes to my son for putting on the music to that timeline. He works over at Merritt's. The second short video is taken from YouTube, and it will show shots from the aircraft in flight, so I hope you enjoy that. That's about 5 minutes worth. Also, I've worked with Stu Watts at Boeing for the last couple of years doing video editing of our third video, which is the Cape Girardeau Air Show, which was held in June 19th, 2010. And we'll show that in its entirety. That's about 25 minutes. Well, it can be said that the U.S. Navy Blue Angels had their start way back in 1912. The Navy staged a simulated aerial dogfight to demonstrate the capabilities of their newest weapons in its arsenal. After a break for World War I, air shows and flight demonstrations started again and reached a peak in November 1918, when over 200 aircraft performed a flyover at San Diego. After seeing Army aviator Jimmy Doolittle perform a solo acrobatic act, and the Army's acrobatic team called the Three Musketeers at an air show in 1927, a Navy officer, D.W. Tomlinson, helped to form the first official Navy flight demonstration team. The team flew the Boeing F-2B-1 fighter, made their first appearance in January 1928 at San Francisco. Because of these daredevil stunts, they were soon being called the Suicide Trio, and then shortly were given the official name of the Three Seahawks. The short-lived team was followed by other Navy acrobatic teams, which included the High Hatters, the Three Gallant Souls, and the Three Flying Fish. But as worldwide tensions grew and World War II became a grim reality, all military air show performances came to a sudden stop. After World War II, on April 24th of 1946, Admiral Chester Nimitz, then Chief of Naval Operations, issued a directive ordering the formation of a flight demonstration team to maintain the public's interest in naval aviation. The Blue Angels' first performance was on June 15, 1946, at their home base at that time, Naval Air Station Jacksonville. Lieutenant Commander Roy Butch Vorse, a World War II fighter ace, led the initial team. The team used three Grumman F-6F Hellcats at their initial 15-minute air show of common air maneuvers used by pilots during their training. The team also employed an SMJ Texan trainer painted all in yellow to simulate the Japanese Zero in combat. It was named Beetlebob. The book First Blue, the story of World War II ace Butch Vorse and the creation of the Blue Angels was published in 2004 and is available at your St. Louis County Library. The Blue Angels then transitioned from the Hellcat to the more powerful Grumman Bearcat 2 months later, and it was used by the team through July 1949. In 1947, the team introduced their now famous Diamond Formation to their air show routine. In 1949, the SNJ Texan was replaced by the Grumman Bearcat, which was also painted yellow for the air combat routine. July 49, the Bearcat Beetlebound was relegated to solo acrobatics and was used until the end of the 1950 show season. The team's first jet aircraft was introduced on July 13th of 1949, the straight-wing Grumman F-9F Panther. After a break due to the Korean conflict, the team reorganized on October 25th of 1951 to their new home at Naval Air Station, Corpus Christi, Texas. The team then began flying the Grumman F-9F-5 Panther, a newer and slightly faster version of the aircraft. In the winter of 54, the team relocated to their present base, which is Naval Air Station, Pensacola, Florida. And just a footnote, the National Naval Aviation Museum is located there in Pensacola, and it's open to the public. And a guided tour of this vast museum is highly recommended. The Blue Angels practice air shows are held generally twice weekly during selected weeks at the base, and they are also free and open to the general public if you get a chance to go in. During 1954, the winter, the mid-show season, in 1957, the team then progressed to the Swepwing Grumman F9F8 Cougar. For the 1957 show season, the Blue Angels then transitioned to the first supersonic jet, the Grumman F11F-1 Tiger. This aircraft remained with the team until 1969. And at that time, I became interested because I joined McDonnell Douglas, and in 1969, team transitioned to the two-seat McDonnell Douglas F4J Phantom II. Phantom was a high-performance twin-engine jet fighter and was the only aircraft to have been flown at the same time period by both the Blue Angels and the Air Force Thunderbirds demonstration team. On November 8, 1986, the Blue Angels completed their 40th anniversary year, and during ceremonies, they unveiled their present aircraft, the McDonnell Douglas FNA 18 Hornet. First dual-role fighter attack aircraft, which is still serving on our front line of defense. In 2006, Blue Angels marked their 60th year of flight demonstrations. The Blues, as of this year, are celebrating 26th year using the FNA 18 Hornet. At the beginning of the 2011, the team transitioned from the single-seat A and two-seat B models to an updated F-18 C and D models. And additionally, the Blue Angels kicked off their 211 show season with an Area 100th anniversary parade of flight in celebration of the centennial of naval aviation on February 12, 2011, over San Diego. This aerial parade included Navy, Marine Corps, Coast Guard aircraft from pre-World War I to the present Blue Angels FNA 18 Hornet. Also in 2011, and close to home here in St. Louis, the National Naval Aviation Museum in Pensacola permanently loaned a two-seater FNA 18B aircraft for permanent display to the Science Center, and it's mounted on a pedestal outside the McDonald Planetarium in Forest Park, pictured there for you. Dave and I were both in attendance at the dedication ceremony on December 16, 2011. And this aircraft is open to the public. Some facts, basically the 2009 show season brought out more than 8 million spectators to date. Since 1946, the Blues have performed to more than 463 million fans. Blue Angels have also flown many demonstrations overseas since their first deployment back in July 1964 when they performed over Mexico City to an estimated crowd of 1.5 million people. They also have had 4 European tours at 35 different show sites. The South American tour, the Far East tour, Caribbean tour, and then their performance at Mexico City. And in 2012, I've passed out the show schedule for you. They will have several shows commemorating the bicentennial of the War of 1812. So look for that. Ellen, I guess we're ready to show the first 5 minute video if you'd be so kind of run up.
Yeah. Joe, let me chime in. This, I apologize. In your handouts, there are frequently asked questions page back there, which pretty much covers everything you could want to know about the Blue Angels. But if you do have any questions, please hold them until the end of the presentation, and we'll see if we'll get those in.
All right, go ahead.
Okay, we're going to show the first video of the aircraft timeline. I'm going to take a water break.
I'm
80 and...
Thank you.
That's from a different air show.
Oh, okay. I think it was one of that night air shows.
Okay, second part of the discussion now goes to description of the current aircraft. First, we'll talk about the FNA-18C Hornet. These aircraft are former fleet aircraft, are nearly combat ready according to the Navy. They can be repainted and ready for combat service in just 72 hours. Significant modifications to each aircraft include removal of the aircraft gun and replacement with a tank that contains a paraffin-based smoke coil, which is used in the demonstrations. Installation of inverted fuel pumps to increase the time the aircraft can spend inverted without fuel starvation, and outfitting with a control stick spring system that is used to facilitate a more precise aircraft control input. The standard demonstration configuration is such that the pilot must overcome 40 pounds of nose-down stick input to maintain level flight. The Blue Angels do not wear G-suits because the air bladders inside them would repeatedly deflate and inflate, interfering with the control stick, which is between the pilot's leg. Instead, the Blue Angel pilots tense their stomach muscles and legs to prevent blood from rushing from their heads and therefore render them unconscious. Just a little footnote to that. The Blue Angel show narrator flies Blue Angel number 7, which is a two-seat FNA-18D model, to the various show sites, along with the Blue Angels event coordinator prior to each air show to ensure that all air show requirements are met. The Blue Angels also use this jet for backup and to give demonstration flights to civilians, usually members of the press. The number 4 slot pilot often flies the number 7 aircraft in the Friday practice shows. These are also flown to meet the FAA requirements. Just a quick update that the Blue Angels B model number 7 is on display outside of the John Mateus McDonald Planetarium, and that was dedicated back in December 16, 2011. Next, the other aircraft they use is nicknamed Fat Albert. It's a United States Marine Corps Lockheed Martin C-130T Hercules, and it's used for logistics, carrying of spare parts, equipment, and the Blue Angels support personnel between the Blue Angels home base at Pensacola and the airshow sites. An all-Marine Corps crew of 3 officers and 5 enlisted personnel operate the Hercules, affectionately known as Fat Albert Airlines. Fat Albert joined the team in 1970 and flies more than 140,000 miles each show season. It can carry more than 40 maintenance and support personnel, their gear, and enough spare parts and communication equipment to complete a successful air show. Fat Albert cruises at a speed of 360 miles per hour at 27,000 feet. It has 4 Allison turboprop engines producing 16,000 shaft horsepower each, and provides Fat Albert Airlines with the power to land and depart from runways as short as 2,500 feet. Back in 1975, Fat Albert used the jet-assisted takeoff, JADO, as part of their short aerial demonstration just prior to the main event at show sites. Fat Albert performed its final JADO demonstration at the 2009 Pensacola Homecoming Air Show using their last remaining 8 JADO rocket bottles. Now we're set to go in we'll do the next surprise video of Blue Angels, about 5 minutes worth, and we'll take you up in the aircraft. Thank you. Next thing we'd like to talk about is the, before we see the major air show video of Cape Girardeau, we'd like to go over some of the overview of the air show. Blue Angels show season runs from March until November. They perform in both military and civilian airfields, and often perform directly over major cities such as San Francisco's Fleet Week Maritime Festival, Chicago's annual Air and Water Show, which usually is the third weekend in August. And by the way, I think this is the year when they visit the Boeing facility. Every 2 years they come from the Chicago show and visit facilities, meet the employees. And then they also perform at Seattle's Seafarer Festival. The Marine Corps C-130 Thad Albert aircraft performs a short aerial demonstration just prior to the Blue Angels Hornet demonstration. The very impressive Blue Angels impressive short field assault landing is performed with a Thad Albert, stopping within 1,800 feet. During the Hornet acrobatic demonstration, the Blue Angels operate six FNA-18C aircraft, and immediately after takeoff, they split into their diamond formation and then perform their signature diamond 360 maneuver while maintaining a 18-inch wingtip to canopy diamond formation. Blue Angels number one, by the way, is the flight leader. Number two is the right wing. Number three is the left wing, and number four is the slot. Blue Angel pilots number five and six make up the team as the lead and the opposing solos. The solos take off with Blue Angels number five performing the dirty roll on takeoff, followed by number six performing a spectacular low transition pitch up maneuver. Most of the show alternates between maneuvers performed by the diamond and those performed by the solos. The diamond in tight formation and usually flying at lower air speeds perform maneuvers such as formation loops, barrel rolls, fleur-de-lis, the vertical bomb burst maneuver, and transition from one formation to another. One maneuver called the diamond aileron roll features the diamond formation performing a simultaneous rolls. Another maneuver called the diamond dirty loop features the diamond flying a loop with all four jets in the carrier landing configuration. The solos fly many of their maneuvers just under the speed of sound, with a sneak pass being performed at the fastest speed of the air show, about 700 miles per hour. The high performance capabilities of their individual Hornets are being shown through execution of high speed passes, slow passes, fast rolls, slow rolls, and very tight turns. Some of the maneuvers include both solos performing at once, such as opposing passes, which appear to be on a collision course, mirror formations, back-to-back, belly-to-belly, or wingtip to wingtip, and one jet flying inverted. During this section high alpha pass, the two solos perform the slowest maneuver in the air show. During this tail-sitting maneuver, the two jets slow down to 125 knots, pitch up their aircraft to 45 degrees. During the minimum radius turn maneuver, the highest G-force in the air show is countered by the solos. In this maneuver, number five flies the horizontal loop, pulling a high G of 7 to maintain a tight radius. The most difficult formation maneuver to do well is called the line abreast loop. Solo number five joins the diamond, and then all five jets fly a loop in a straight line. The solos then join the diamond near the end of the show for a number of maneuvers in the six-jet delta formation. In the loop break cross, also known as the delta breakout, the solos join the diamond and the six aircraft break out in six different directions, perform half Cuban eights, and then cross over the center of the performance area, followed by their famous delta pitch-up break to landing. I think now we're ready to show you the air show from start to finish. That was done in Cape Girardeau on June 19, 2010. And then we'll have immediately following day, we'll present this topic. I now present the Blue Angel show. Let it roll, Alan.
Thank you.
Next, we'll have Dave Control to present aerial photography and surprise.
Since you worked at Mac longer than I did, it took most of the time, I'm just going to keep mine short tonight. I just want to talk a little bit about shooting action shots. I'm sure most of you have shot some air shows before, but just a few things that I want to talk about. Number one is you have to anticipate the action. I do a lot of sports photography. My cousin played for Dallas Cowboys, who football team. And when they come to play the Cardinals in St. Louis, I got a pass to go down the field and shoot some action shots. So that was kind of neat. I did shoot, I mean photograph, President Carter down in Memphis. We had he was on a book signing tour. We met him in Peabody Hotel. We set up video. We were doing a video shoot. I was doing a still photography in Danny Thomas's suite. So the Secret Service came in, looked the place over, looked us over, looked our equipment, and then 5 o'clock he walked in. We spent about 2 hours with him. So if anybody asked me who'd you photograph, the most famous person, it'd probably have to be Jimmy Carter. And there was other people I photographed too that were high profile. Well, like I said, you have to anticipate, you have to have a good camera. I shoot with Canons and Nikons, and some medium telephoto lens I use. This is a 70 to 300 millimeter. I do have a 500 millimeter, but that's overkill. That's harder to focus. And then I have some wide angles for some of the static displays. That's a very useful lens too. But this is my main lens that I use. I used to shoot on manual, now I just shoot on automatic. This is an 18 megapixel camera, which is very, very good. And I kind of like Canon just a little bit for action shots over Nikon, but they're both good cameras. I shoot about 8 frames a second. Some cameras go 12 frames per second. I shoot here, there's a high end and a low speed, it's like 4 frames per second. I shoot at 8 frames per second. So you have to anticipate the action, just like sports action shots, you anticipate the action, you know, where they're going to be, where they're coming from, what their maneuver is going to be, like Joe mentioned the maneuvers before you saw them. So you kind of anticipate what's going to happen. So you get in your position, and then you can go ahead and pan with the action shot and just click away. Just click away. I may shoot 200 shots just to get one good one. An example of that would be the Thunderbird photos back there. There's two of them. One is tail to tail, and the other one is belly to belly. And somebody said, oh, you photoshopped that. It's the same plane, you just printed it upside down. No, it's two different planes. There's two different numbers on them. So that was a lucky shot, a very lucky shot. This is a lucky shot too. Some of you seen the Tora Tora group from Texas?
Oh yeah.
They come up about 7 or 8 Japanese Zero planes. This was at Scott Base last time they were here, second to last time they were here. And I just photographed a plane coming right through when a bomb was dropped by another one. It just came out perfect. I mean, I couldn't have placed it any better. When I had the flybys, they come within 18 inches, wingtip to wingtip, 18 to 24 inches, wingtip to wingtip. And it gives you an appearance like, I mean, they are really close, very close. And you'll see some of the other ones around here. I like when they take off and when they land, you can get some real neat photographs when they're taking off and when they are landing too. One of my favorites is the shot of Nicole over here. She was the first woman pilot for the Thunderbirds. You probably read a lot about her when she came out 2006. She was the right wing. She flew the right wing over here. And I took an individual portrait of her and then placed her in there. I made kind of a collage with the group photo. But she was the first woman demonstration pilot. Now the Blue Angels, they have some too. They're not in the top five. As you saw here, this gal was number eight. So she flies with the Navigator. Or, yeah, Eric.
This year's team I saw already, and they have a number three as a woman.
Thunderbirds?
This will be a third one.
Okay. So women are becoming more and more into, and the requirements are really tough to get into these demonstration teams. You got to have so many hours, aircraft landings, so many hours. They have to be combat groomed. There's just so many requirements to get in these groups. It's very selective. You can look at this after a while if you want. I got about 7,000 photos on my computer. We don't have time tonight to look at it. But I do have a lot of photographs of airplanes and stuff. When the Fiji was in town this summer, past summer, Joe and I went out there and I got some great photographs of that B-29. I can show you too sometime. And the B-25.
Yeah.
I got some photographs of that. We went out there and took some photographs. I do collect models, trains, planes, NASCAR, IndyCar. This is just about an eighth of my collection. I got several hundred planes, but some of these are the more historic ones. If you saw the Red Tail movie, that's this plane right here, the Mustang. There's two versions of the Mustang that they used. You can look at those. And if you haven't seen the movie, go see the movie. It is awesome. And I think they only did three or four planes in the whole movie. They multiplied them digitally. So it's amazing how they make these movies today using one or two planes to get 30, you know. So take a look at that. I have some photographs. We won't have time tonight, but I'll let you guys decide when. I have some early photographs. 1920 is, well, it was in 1879 of the balloon race, but 1920 photographs of Lambert Field and the activities that took place up there. There's the first aircraft or air traffic controller, picture of him. And I got these from a Model T guy, a friend of mine. His dad worked out there, a mechanic, I think, at Robinson Aircraft. And George Herwick, these are some of his photographs. Some of them are in this book, too, which Alan showed not too long ago. If you don't have this book, I would get it. It's a really good book on aviation in St. Louis. I'm also a Lindbergh fan, and I also have photographs of Lindbergh in this plane from the 1920s. Some of these are out of Lambert. You've probably never seen them before. And some of these are very rare photographs. And here's a good book on Lindbergh, if you want to get a book about his biography. This is an excellent book, too. And I have some books up here. McDonnell Douglas, history. And I belong to the Model T Club, and I told the guy, I said, you know, Henry Ford hired James S. McDonnell. After he graduated from MIT, and two other guys, Henry Ford hired him, which was Stout Metal Aircraft Company. It was a subsidiary of Ford Automobile Company, and they built the tri-motor. So James McDonnell was part of those three engineers that made that tri-motor plane. But then Henry Ford fired him.
Yeah.
It's a good thing, too, because then he started his own factory here in St. Louis. But he was wearing knickers. He was on the wing, and Henry was taking a tour through the aircraft plant one day and saw McDonald up on the wing with knickers on. He says, fire that guy. So that's what happened. It's in the book. You can read it in the book, too. But a friend of mine worked at McDonald, and he told me the same thing. And that's what he heard. That he got fired, and then he started his company out here. There's a couple drawings over here. I went to a train show down in Baldwin. Every year they have a train show, and somebody sold these McDonald drawings. You know, there's I don't know the guy's name, and it says, you know, this is 1,635 or 2,000. I don't know what that means, that number there. But these are original drawings. What I did is I photographed it, and then I added contrast to it, and that's what I got, those prints there. I got about six of these drawings.
Wow.
So I you know, this is a poor representation. There's a little bubbles and stuff, but correct that Photoshop, and then I made those prints from these drawings. So I have a bunch of stuff up here. You can come up and look at it. And if you have any questions, we'll be glad to answer questions. Take a look at these models. This is the greatest aircraft. I mean, I worked on the F-4, and I thought that was great. 1960s, Vietnam War. Except we had problems with the ejection seat. Pilots were breaking arms, and that was one of the things in our department we had to fix. But today, the F-18. I prefer this over the F-16. The F-16, they fly by wire, just, you know, the right hand on the side. With this, the stick's in the middle. And this is a great plane, the F-18. As you can see by that second video, straight up. I mean, it's just amazing what this plane can do. That's all I have. If you want to see some of these photos of early Lambert Field or historic, you can come up and look at them. I'll let it run. And then, any questions?
Joe, it sounds like you're also a rail fan, I can tell.
A what?
A rail fan. You like trains, too.
Trains. Oh, yeah.
Okay. Did you see Meet 44 when it came into town?
No.
You didn't? Oh, you missed it?
No.
Oh.
Yeah, I did. It came to Kirkley. Yeah. But I got the other steam engine, the 3985. I got some great photographs of that.
Matt and I were out making it that day. We caught it. Beautiful shot. Long that Greenwood Drive, you know, parallels the track for several blocks. Perfect spot. But he came around the corner, and that's where Sutton Avenue crosses the tracks. It's a great crossing. And the engineer puts away the shot. Beautiful.
Take a look at some of my photographs. There's that whole display back there is mine. Joe made a calendar out of my photographs a couple of years ago. Any questions, be happy to answer.
Turn it over to Daniel here.
Actually, we got a question from Mitch.
Go ahead, Rich.
Yeah, I got questions here and comments. I got a chance to work with, this is towards the Blue Angel presentation. I got a chance to work very closely with them for the Centennial Naval Aviation. Here's a couple of things that you probably don't know. Chicago Air and Water Show is an extremely difficult show for the Blue Angels to fly. They have to put down a marker that's about 400 feet long. You can't do that on the water very well, but they do. And the CO has to be a second-year CO. He can't be in his first year as commanding officer of the Blue Angels to fly that show. He's got to be a second-year guy. Huh. So that's why it's an alternating show, and that's why the Thunderbirds fly it every other year. I think they do. The JADO, I was on the flight the day after the final JADO show. That's a hell of a ride in that C-130. I mean, you go from plus 3.5 G's to minus 5 on the pushover for landing. So it's incredible. I didn't throw up, I thought about it. As a general rule, the Blue Angels and the Thunderbirds cannot fly within 150 miles of each other on the same weekend. It's a DOD directive because they want to get the airplanes out to, you know, as far away from each other as possible and meet see as many people as they can. We, for the Centennial, tried to get a reunion show at Andrews, and it was turned down by the Department of Defense. So, good to do it. The Blue Angels in 2009 went to a two-year planning cycle as opposed to a one-year planning cycle, so they planned 2 years. They tried to get 100% solution for the year coming up. And then about 85 to 90 things change in that time frame. And right now, like it was said, they're supporting the War of 1812 stuff. Here's another little tidbit from Missouri. Cape Girardeau tends to score very high at what's called the International Council Air Shows, where all the performers get together, Blue Angels and Thunderbirds, where they announce their season every year in December in Las Vegas. And Cape Girardeau consistently scores very high. And I think the year I was at ICAS, they won the best small show in the country. So, you know, whatever they're doing it right because the Blue Angels love Cape Girardeau.
But they're not having it now anymore.
For sure. Well, they've got to go someplace else. I mean, they go by Nielsen ratings and you know, how many recruitable people are there in the area. So they've got to, you know, go to everywhere.
So I'm going to talk about the Cape Toronto Air Show. It's not, was canceled this year.
Okay. Yeah. But, you know, a lot of money is hinged on the selection of where those shows take place. So when a city or a state or a county or whatever gets it, it's a big deal.
Yeah. We, you know, back when we did the St. Louis County Fair and Air Show, that was typically almost guaranteed every 2 years we would get the Blues. And so that was always a real treat. I want to thank Joe and Dave for the wonderful presentation tonight. I just have a side story to talk about the Blues for a second. And, you know, one of their jobs, job description, would be that they're ambassadors for the U.S. Navy, 24/7, 365. They do that very well. But, you know, you come out here, you see the yanking and banking and stuff, and that's really great. But a little more heartfelt story I'm going to tell you is that, and I wish Bob, a friend of mine, and was part of the IPMS group, is Bob Fisher, his son Robbie. And they were going to try to make it tonight, but they couldn't. Robbie's what now, 20, I think 21, 22?
Yeah, that sounds about right.
22? Okay. And he's still wheelchair bound. So, you know, Bob has to take him everywhere. Well, back, you know, 2007 was our last air show out of Spirit. I can't remember the exact time frame, but I want to say it was in that next summer, next season. Since we have contract fuel there at the airport, the Blue Angels do come through and stop through and get gas on their way to some of the northern air shows occasionally. And the guy that I had dealt with that for that last season in 07 was Major Nathan Miller, who was the, I believe he was the, I don't remember, the narrator, does that sound right? And then Lieutenant Dan McShane was the event coordinator. So got to know them real well. I told Nathan about Robbie, and I knew they were coming through for gas one day, so Bob brought Robbie out, and I didn't expect, you know, I thought, okay, he's going to get to go see some of the guys and see the planes a little bit, and that'll be about it. They literally met Robbie in the terminal building there and just swarmed over him. I couldn't believe the outpouring, and they signed autographs, pictures, gave him all kinds of pins, everything. It was just, it was really overwhelming. And I'll never forget that as long as I live. So, you know, it just they're wonderful people. Everybody that supports them. You think about all the shows. You think about, I don't know how many shows they do. Look at one of those sheets. I mean, that's a lot. Every season, you know. And it's almost like a NASCAR schedule. So, and as a matter of fact, I just emailed Nate Miller. Now Lieutenant Colonel, he's the XO of VMFA 251, and they just deployed on the final cruise of USS Enterprise, so they're over in off Iran someplace right now, I don't know exactly where. But anyhow, I want to say our next, Alan, I know we didn't firm up a date for May's meeting yet, but it'll typically be around the third week of, that's typically how it's been working out, is the third Thursday of the month. I know Thursday that night is blocked, so we may have to do it on a Wednesday night. But Alan, and some of you may know this and some of you may not, Alan had presented here about a month or so ago, and it's starting to get growing, is to do a dedicated book on Lambert Field. We're going to actually have our first work group slant planning meeting prior to our next general meeting. So it'll probably be around 5:30 or so here in, hopefully the ninth floor of our room here that we're going to now. I'll send an email about that closer to the time. But if anybody at all is interested in helping out with this book project, please think about coming to that. It's going to be, you know, it's not going to happen overnight, obviously. And we were discussing the other day that I think as a kind of a doable goal is to shoot for 2020, which will be the centennial of Lambert Field. And I'm sure there will be celebrations aplenty for that. So that's, what, about 6 years from now, roughly, six or seven? So hopefully it won't take that long to do a nice book, but it gives us plenty of time to plan and get everything rolling for us. So I just want to thank everybody again for coming out tonight. Make sure you get your parking ticket stamped. And any other questions or comments? Go ahead. Rick?
Yeah, I've got a quick question for Joe or anybody who might know the story. But in watching some of these flight demos, I'm very impressed by the tightness of the formations. And I'm wondering if some of the, well, for example, one that really impressed me was a four-ship diamond formation where all four aircraft rolled in the same direction simultaneously. And I'm wondering if those things are worked out on computer before they're ever flown.
Basically, a lot of the new pilots have to go on the simulator before they even fly their training in a lot of those maneuvers, especially the landing gear down, coming down with the speed brake time. That was done that way too. And then they usually train a new guy with an experienced guy, so they don't go out and fly right into diamond, they go in pairs. And then they start adding a third pilot. So they train at El Centro, California, the 2 months there before the show season starts. Good question.
But I'm aware that there's a lot of elbow room needed in a rolling maneuver. It's not a roll right straight about the airplane axis that just makes a straight line through the sky. There's a little more to it than that, and I'm wondering about four of them rolling in the same direction simultaneously, if there needs to be something. Yeah. Define.
A lot of practice.
Say what?
A lot of practice.
Well, yeah, but practice like that, OJT leads to bent metal.
Aileron rolls are pretty much on the axis of the airplane. It varies slightly, but not a hell of a lot.
Well, I haven't driven an F-18, so I can't say with certainty. But
I flew through 1538 and did aileron. It was pretty straight.
I also want to make sure everybody signs, especially if you're new for the first time tonight, can you please sign the book back here? And we'd love to stay in contact with you, with your email or phone number or something. I see some new faces. I mean, if we have time, everybody wants to. I see some new people. If you're new here tonight for the first time, if you could introduce yourself, that would be wonderful. Anybody new here tonight for the first time? Go ahead, back here.
I'm David Cunningham.
Okay.
And I graduated with Joe Gurney from Parks.
Oh, excellent. All right.
Same year, same time.
Okay.
And this is my son, Mark.
Nice to meet you, sir. All right. Back here with somebody?
My name's Tim Howard. I'm at the Parks. Years after Joe, I'm not that old. So.
Wow, we got the Parks alumni here tonight. Back over here, go ahead.
I'm John Keek. I'm an airplane designer at Boeing, previously McDonnell Douglas, and
okay.
I've been a pilot since 1956.
Wow, okay, all right. Welcome. And yes, sir, go ahead.
Bob Rockford. I soloed 64 years ago.
Holy cow.
He's also
okay. What type of plane did you solo in, sir?
Oh, the travel air. I'm trying to think of a name.
That's okay. I got a rough picture of it in my mind, I believe. So. Well, anybody wants to come up and look at the models and books? Feel free to do so. Thanks for coming out. Thank you very much.